And the second technique is called active listening, in which we learn to listen more actively and ask questions which help that person to externalize himself even more clearly and helps us to understand more clearly what is going on inside of him. Now, before we go on to how those two tools are used, let's talk a bit about how people communicate today. One way, one means of communication is non-communication, that is, suppression. Many people, especially women, especially in this area of the world, have been programmed not to express needs, not to express desires or feelings, to suppress them. So one means of communication is suppression. I don't tell the other person what I'm feeling. I don't externalize what my needs are, and I wait for the other person to know, and then I become unhappy when this other person is not responding to needs which I have not expressed very clearly. I have not made it very clear that this bothers me, or that I would like to have this, or I have certain needs, whatever that may be. When those are not expressed very clearly, what is the result? First of all, it's very clear that suppressed emotions create illness. All kinds of rheumatic problems, arthritic problems, cancer, headaches, hormonal problems, colitis, ulcers, all of these psychosomatic illnesses are created by negative emotions, which are causing a restriction of energy flow in the body, a disturbance in the hormones, and the suppression of the functioning of the immunological system. That is, the defense system of the body is weakened by these unexpressed emotions. So the body is just ready for illness. It could be inflammations, it could be cancerous cells, it could be various types of problems and disturbances in the body. Secondly, it's a disturbance in the mind. The mind is never really relaxed. This is sitting in the subconscious, this feeling of hurt, this feeling of injustice, this feeling of not being satisfied, of not being respected, of not being loved. These feelings are in there, and they're working in the subconscious, and they're occupying a great deal of the subconscious mind. So there's less creativity, less peace of mind, less clarity in our daily functioning. Another result is that all of our feelings are actually transmitted to the other person anyway. We call this is the effect of two connected containers. That is, if I have a container here and a container here, and there's a pipe which is connecting them, and there's water, if I push the water down in this container, it comes up in the other. So if I am one container and my wife is another container, or my friend or my child or my mother, whatever I suppress in myself is actually transmitted to the other person when there's a close relationship. And that person is receiving those messages subconsciously and is reacting to us in response to what we're really feeling, and not in response to the mask that we're wearing. And so then we feel double injustice. That is, we've been suppressing ourselves, we haven't been asking for what we need. The other person is reacting not to that, but to the resentment which is building up within us, and the anger which is building up within us. And we feel a second injustice by the fact that after all of this sacrifice, this person is still not treating us well. But he's just reflecting, or she is just reflecting, our real suppressed emotions, which are being mirrored in our relationships. That all our relationships are mirrors of what we are feeling, and those emotions are transmitted, so we don't really gain anything. In fact, some of the people who teach about effective communication use the example of the brown stamps that they used to have in America. That every time you bought something, you collected a certain number of stamps. I think they have it in Martinopolis here too. You get coupons, and then when you've got enough coupons, you get the reward. You know, and so some people just collect stamps every time this injustice takes place. And when you've got enough coupons, then you can just explode on the other person with all of this anger. I mean, this is the reward, yeah? And the other guy doesn't know what's happening. What is this reaction? It's completely disproportionate to what I've done at this moment, and he doesn't know that I've been accumulating these stamps for 2 or 3 months by all of these small things that are happening that I don't mention, that I don't explain. So I'm just gathering a lot of negativity. The other person feels that injustice is being done to him because he feels that our reactions are out of proportion to what he's doing, and everyone's unhappy. It would be much easier to mention all of those little events one by one when they happen rather than to accumulate. So this type of person, the one who suppresses himself, in a way is expecting the other person to know our needs, our feelings, our beliefs, our desires, what bothers us, what doesn't bother us. And the other person is in his own world. He's been brought up in another family. He has different programming, different beliefs, different needs. What bothers us doesn't bother him. Perhaps what bothers him doesn't bother us. And he has no way of knowing unless we explain it. He also may be very tired. He also may have a lot of problems, which doesn't allow him or her the possibility of thinking about what may be going on in us. In order for you to think about other persons, you've got to be rather happy, rather satisfied. I mean, you have to have solved quite a few of your own problems. Otherwise, you're living in your own world, surrounded by your own problems, and the needs of other persons are not important to you. It may be egotistical, but it's very natural. And it's the way most of humanity lives, because most of humanity has not solved their own personal problems. People live within their own. So we expect these persons to be mind readers in a certain way.